Hello. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to ICTS, to the majority of you who have come from your respective institutions to ICTS for this very special lecture. It's very nice to welcome you here. For those of you who haven't been here before, ICTS is a new research center of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And in addition to our research in various areas in theoretical physics, mathematics, quantitative biology, and going ahead, computer science as well, we also host a lot of programs, visitors, and public lectures, and events like this. So if you are more interested, please check out our webpage. We have a lot of our previous talks archived over there, so you might find a lot of interesting resources on this YouTube channel called ICTS Talks. That's one word. We also have this copy with curiosity event in the planetarium, which again, if you haven't been to, I would encourage you to check it out. It's held once a month on a Sunday afternoon at the planetarium. This Sunday, we are having one the 20th, so at 3 o'clock at the planetarium, and it's on the periodic table. This, we are celebrating the 150th year of the periodic table, and so we have a very good chemist from the Tata Institute in Mumbai who will be coming and telling us about the history and some lot of fun facts about the periodic table, and even bringing along some very rare elements which you may not have seen. So if you or your friends are interested, come this Sunday to the planetarium. So it's now my pleasant task to introduce Professor Karp. It's truly a privilege to have him here to visit ICTS and to have him deliver this ICTS Distinguished Lecture, which is one of our very special lectures by eminent scientists who are meant for a general scientific audience. So it's a great honor to have Professor Karp give this, because he's one of the legendary computer scientists who has played such an influential role in shaping a lot of modern theoretical computer science. And in a way, his talk and through his talk, you'll see the sort of the breadth of the contributions. But it spans both theory and practice, and that's very unique, I think, to find someone who straddles both of them and has made very important contributions to them. So he has many seminal contributions, but among the most celebrated are the ones about the NP-completeness of computational problems, about which we'll hear. And then he's also worked on parallel algorithms and combinatorial optimization algorithms and randomized algorithms for combinatorial problems, etc. And his recent activities have been around algorithmic methods and genomics and also deep learning and so on, about again, we'll hear a bit. As a celebrated computer scientist, he's been a recipient of many, many honors. I must say that when I had to sort of pick and choose, if I may say so, it was an NP hard problem to pick a suitable subset of awards to highlight. But I'll just say, give a subset. The US National Medal of Science, one of the highest honors in the US, the Turing Award, the Fulkerson Prize, the Harvey Prize, the Centennial Medal from Harvard. Professor Karp, I forgot to mention, did his undergraduate and graduate degrees at Harvard, and then joined the IBM T.J. Watson Center before joining Berkeley, where he is currently university professor. He's a member of various national academies, the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, as well as engineering, the French Academy of Sciences, the American Philosophical Society, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and the ACM, the Association of Computing Machinery. So that's, again, as I said, just a small subset. And I would probably give a lecture as long as Professor Karp's if I dwelt on all of them. Since you've come not to hear me, but Professor Karp, I will now invite Professor Karp to come and deliver the lecture on computational complexity in theory and practice. But before the lecture, we have a small little ritual here. I'd like to invite Dr. Manish Gupta, who is heading the Google Research Labs. Maybe you've all read in the papers about the newly set up Google Research Labs in Bangalore. I'd like to invite Dr. Manish Gupta to come on stage on behalf of ICTS and Google, give a memento to Professor Karp. This is a sandalwood Buddha.
Okay. With this headdress, I feel like a creature from a science fiction movie. It's a great pleasure to visit this wonderful Center for Theoretical Science. I was one of the founders of a similar institute in Berkeley, but focused differently, having in common with this one computer science, but then focused in other directions. And so I appreciate how beautifully this one is organized. I think we all encountered algorithms very early in our lives. We learned the school book algorithms for arithmetic. As you progress into college and take a computer science course, you will learn about surprisingly efficient ways for sorting a list of numbers. Some fundamental algorithms will be brought to your attention: shortest path algorithms, minimum spanning tree, network flow algorithms. You'll learn about linear programming and the marvelous algorithms that are known for the fundamental problem of minimizing a linear function of n variables subject to linear inequality constraints. And you may hear about the problem of testing whether a number is prime, and you may wonder whether there's an efficient way to do this. One way is to just go through the numbers smaller than the number you're testing. 1, 2, 3, divide each of those numbers into the number in question. And so, for example, you'll be able to decide that 91 is not a prime, it's the product of two other numbers. You'll also encounter along the way problems which seem somehow more challenging and seem to require, they have the character of looking for a needle in a haystack. For example, suppose you're given a big party, 150 students or so, and you somehow know which students are compatible socially with other students, and you want to decide what is the largest set of students that are mutually compatible. In graph theory language, what is the size of the largest clique in a graph? And you may wonder whether there's some way of finding the largest clique in a graph and verifying that it is largest without doing the brute force thing of just looking at every subset of the vertices and seeing if it forms a clique. You might be introduced to the problem of factoring large integers, deciding whether an integer is prime, and if it's not prime, finding two factors to multiply. So if you're given the number 91, you'll quickly return 7 times 13. But if you're given a 20 or 30 digit decimal number, you might have great, great difficulties in finding a pair of factors. And you might begin to wonder whether this problem really can be solved without brute force search. Another problem that challenges is the problem of dividing a set of numbers into two parts with equal sum. So here you're given a list of numbers 4, 43, 56, 81, and so on. And you want to decide whether there's some way of splitting the numbers into two parts such that the sum of the numbers in each part is exactly half of the total sum. And again, there's a brute force method available, clearly, and you can just try all the partitions. But we would like something better, and we don't know whether something better exists. So this introduces us to the relevance of computational complexity theory, the branch of computer science in which we study the intrinsic difficulty of solving particular problems. And many of these problems have this needle in a haystack property that you're looking for a structure within a larger structure, and it's not evident whether you can do it without brute force. In a 1972 paper called Reducibility Among Combinatorial Problems, I showed that a large number, here I'm quoting myself, we show that a large number of classic unsolved problems of covering, matching, packing, routing, assignment, and sequencing are equivalent in the sense that either each of them possesses a polynomial time algorithm or none of them does. And this work, which showed the equivalence in a certain sense of all these problems and more, was stimulated by an important theorem by Stephen Cook from 1971. So in order to formulate this question of which search problems are efficiently solvable and which require combinatorial explosions, we need to set the stage with a few definitions. So we're going to think of a combinatorial problem as one where the input is a string of symbols from some alphabet, say the alphabet 0, 1. And all of the input strings are possible of any length whatsoever. And there's some criterion determining the problem and telling which of these strings should be accepted and which should be rejected. And a decision problem is simply the question of deciding for any given string whether it's accepted or rejected. So in the case of coloring the vertices of a graph, you can figure out an encoding scheme where a given graph, you all know that a graph is just a set of vertices, some of which are connected by edges. And you know that you can encode a graph in various ways with a sequence of as a string of symbols. And then you'd like to have an algorithm that accepts, let's say, graphs that can be colored with three colors and rejects all other graphs. So that's what a decision problem is. And very importantly, the problem is the whole ensemble of strings. The individual strings are the instances of the problem, but we're always interested not in a particular input string, but complexity theory focuses on the property of the problem as defined over all possible input strings. And there are two important classes of problems that will concern us. The first of these is called P, and it's the class of decision problems for which there is a polynomial time algorithm that correctly decides whether any string is accepted or rejected. What is a polynomial time algorithm? It's an algorithm for the problem such that the number of basic computation steps, add, subtract, multiply, compare, and so on. The number of basic operations required to solve the instance grows only as a polynomial function of the size of the instance. By a polynomial function, we mean one which is of the form n or n squared or n cubed or n to some fixed power, where n is the length of the input string, the size of the instance, as contrasted with problems that might require more than polynomial time, like 2 to the nth power. So that's P. And P is very important for the study of computational complexity because it represents the class of problems that we would consider to be efficiently solvable, polynomial time solvable. Now, NP is what is a class of problems that appears to be bigger than P, because here, like the problems in P, they're decision problems, and you're given strings to accept or reject. But now, we'll say that the problem is in the class NP. If there's a way of giving a short hint, a string which reveals the solution to the problem. Think, for example, of the problem of coloring the vertices of a graph with the three colors red, blue, and green, subject to the constraint that you can never have two neighboring vertices of the same color. That's called the three-coloring problem. And we don't know how hard it is to solve the three-coloring problem, but there is a polynomial time witness that will reveal the answer, yes or no, and that's just the assignment of the colors to the vertices, the obvious thing. So P is the class of problems that are efficiently solvable. NP is the class of problems for which solutions are verifiable efficiently, given a witness, a clue to the solution. So examples in NP are graph coloring, maximum independent set, maximum clique. Another one would be integer solution of systems of linear inequalities. And again, the problem doesn't look as if it's in P, it's polynomially solvable, but there is an easy witness, namely writing down the solution. And so the problem is in the class NP. Okay, so we now know about these two classes of problems. And at this point, we can pose a very famous problem, the most famous theoretical problem in computer science, and one for which there's a $1 million prize to the solver. And this is the problem of deciding whether the classes P and NP are the same. We'll return to that. That's called the P versus NP problem. Now, we now want to organize the relative complexities of various problems, and we'll use a notion of reducibility. So suppose you have a problem X, which is where you have to accept or reject every string, and another problem, Y, where again you have to accept or reject every string. And it turns out that these problems are really intimately related in that there is a way of rewriting any instance of problem X to obtain an instance of problem Y, such that when you rewrite the problem within X, the problem within Y will be solvable, the answer will be yes, will be accepted, if and only if the original problem is in Y. So, in other words, intuitively, problem X is reducible to problem Y if you can transform any input to X to a problem in Y and use the result of that problem to tell you the result of problem X. It maps accepted inputs for X to accepted inputs for Y, and rejected inputs for X to rejected inputs for Y. And in a remarkable result in 1971, Stephen Cook proved that every problem in NP is polynomial time reducible to a certain problem that we'll encounter called the SAT problem, SAT for satisfiability. Now, what that tells us is that if you had an easy algorithm for the satisfiability problem, you would also get an easy algorithm for any particular problem you wish in NP. Because of this reducibility property. To take an input to some problem, all you have to do is perform the transformation that maps it to an input to the satisfiability problem, get the answer about the satisfiability problem, and that will give you the answer to the problem, to the original problem. That's a bit of a mouthful, but basically, what it says is that the satisfiability problem is as hard as any problem in NP, because if you could solve it efficiently, you could solve all the problems in NP efficiently. Okay, so polynomial time reducibility will be our means of comparing the difficulties of pairs of problems. And we'll say that a problem in NP is NP-complete if every problem in NP is reducible to that problem. Such a problem, X, is in some sense the hardest problem in NP. It carries, it supports the solution of any problem in NP. So intuitively, the NP-complete problems are the hardest problems in NP. And P is equal to NP if and only if the NP-complete problems lie in P. In particular, because of Cook's result, the satisfiability problem is NP-complete. It's, again, an intuitive interpretation is that the satisfiability problem is complicated enough to express any problem in the class NP. So in my 1972 paper, I proved that the following 21 problems are NP-complete. And these are just representative of a huge number of problems in the class NP, which are also NP-complete in the sense that that solving any one of them would permit all the others to be solved. So in particular, all 21 of these problems, and in general, all NP-complete problems, are equivalent in the sense that either all of them or none of them lie in the class P. So it would be worth knowing whether P is equal to NP. And either outcome has interesting consequences. If P is unequal to NP, that means that there are lots of problems in NP that are not in the class P, not efficiently solvable. And as a matter of fact, one can say further that most problems in NP, in this case, are not efficiently solvable because experience shows that many thousands of different problems, and any problem that you specify that's in NP seems to turn out to be NP-complete. NP-completeness is a property that's enjoyed by most problems in the class NP. So if P is unequal to NP, that's bad news because it means that most of those problems, all the NP-complete problems, are not solvable in polynomial time, and you have to rely to some kind of brute force search to solve them. On the other hand, if P is equal to NP, then every property that is verifiable, every property in the class NP, is also decidable in polynomial time. And that's generally a good property, but on the other hand, some important things are based on the complexity, on the inability of solving problems. In particular, cryptographic systems based on secret keys would become insecure if P is equal to NP. We would be able to break all of the currently used cryptographic codes, and that means that all of the secrets that we transmitted through cryptography over the generations in the past and all generations in the future will be open to breaking, can be broken by solving the problem of whether P is equal to, in the case that P is equal to NP. Intuitively, most of us would feel that P is unequal to NP simply because it would be too good to believe that all of these problems are easily solvable. But the question of whether P is unequal to NP remains an open theoretical question. Now, I mentioned the satisfiability problem earlier. I said that Stephen Cook had shown the satisfiability problem to be NP-complete. What is that problem? It's a simple problem in Boolean algebra. To describe this problem, we need a little notation. The letters A, B, C, and so on represent Boolean variables, variables that range over the values true and false. And prime represents negation. So if B is true, then B prime is false, and vice versa. B prime is called the complement of B. And the plus sign represents the logical OR operation. So we can read off the top line as the following set of clauses. Each of these expressions is called a clause. A or B prime, B or C, A prime or C prime, etc. And we see that this particular set of clauses, which constitutes an instance of the satisfiability problem, is satisfiable because if we set A false, B false, and C true, then we will have a true literal in each clause. For example, in the second clause, B or C, C is true. In the first clause, B prime is true, etc. And if there exists such a truth assignment which makes all the clauses true, then that instance of the satisfiability problem is solvable, is solved. So solving an instance of the satisfiability problem is determining whether there's a truth assignment that satisfies all the given clauses. And with a bit further thought, it's possible to show that the second problem, with an additional clause after the first one, that the second problem is unsatisfiable. No truth assignment can satisfy all the clauses. So the satisfiability problem is a fundamental NP-complete problem, and it arises quite often in areas such as program verification, digital design, and so on. Now, it's widely believed that every exact problem for the satisfiability problem has worst-case complexity that grows as 2 to the power n. Basically, that's saying that any algorithm that solves the satisfiability problem in all cases has to resort to a process as complex as listing all the possible truth assignments. And nevertheless, practitioners consider the satisfiability problem an easy problem, and a class of programs called SAT solvers solve industrial strength instances with millions of variables without difficulty. So there's something special, perhaps, about the instances that arise in practice, because these SAT solvers can crack them even despite the theoretical complexity. These solvers employ the following inference rule called resolution. Suppose you have two clauses which C and D, where C contains a clause which conflicts with, C contains a literal, a variable or its complement, which conflicts with a literal in D. For example, C might contain A and D might contain A prime. And any time you have that situation, you can infer from those two clauses another clause which contains all the literals in C, in the given clauses, except for the conflicting pair of literals. And I'll give you a couple of examples to make you more comfortable with this definition of resolution. So if we look, if we go to the top, just under input, we see two clauses, A or B prime and B or C. So those two clauses contain a conflicting pair of literals, B prime and B. And the resolution rule says that from those two, you can infer another clause that has to be true if those two are true. Namely, taking away the conflicting literals, you get a new clause, A or C. If you go to the second and third clause in that row, you get B or C and A prime or C prime, and you can resolve the C against the C prime, and you derive A prime or B, and so on. And one way to show that this set of clauses is unsatisfiable is to start with the given clauses and derive new clauses by the resolution principle until we finally get down to the empty clause, which cannot be satisfied. And that tells us that the set of clauses is not satisfiable. I'm going to skip the next slide, which gives a little sense of how the SAT solvers work. But in the interest of time, I'll simply say that they're based on clever choice of clever rules for deciding which resolution steps to perform as you go along. Now, we tend to believe that P is different from NP. So we believe that there are problems in NP that cannot be solved in polynomial time. And we would like to have a notion of the approximate solution of a problem. To do that, we move from the realm of decision problems to the realm of maximization problems or minimization problems. So there, instead of just calling an instance true or false, instead of designating an instance either accepted or rejected, we give it a numerical value, and we ask them to maximize some function of the instance. So, for example, instead of taking the satisfiability problem, we will associate with every instance the maximum number of clauses that can be simultaneously satisfied. And that'll be called the maximization problem. And we can then talk about approximation algorithms that satisfy a large number of instances, but still a smaller number than the number of instances that should be accepted. So in the problem of finding a maximum clique, we'll assign a value to every graph, every instance of the problem, which is the size of the largest clique in that instance. The size of any clique will be the number of values, vertices it contains. And we're interested in comparing the values that we get by our approximation algorithm from the true value of the optimum number. So an approximation algorithm achieves approximation ratio R of n if on every accepted input of length n, it produces an accepted solution whose value is at least R of n times the cost of an optimal accepted input. So we can talk about a problem which has approximation ratio 1/2. That means there's a polynomial time algorithm for maximizing the value such that we always achieve at least half the optimal value. And there is an extensive theory of interesting approximation algorithms, but there are also negative results about approximation algorithms. I'll just give one example. Maximum 3-sat is the case where 3-sat means that that we're concerned with instances of the satisfiability problem with exactly 3 literals in each clause. And what we want to maximize is the number of clauses satisfied. And it can be shown that for this max clique problem, satisfying as high a fraction as possible of the number of clauses that can be satisfied, no constant factor approximation algorithm let's go down to the second one. For the maximum 3-sat problem, no polynomial time approximation ratio can exceed 7/8 unless p is equal to np. And for the maximum clique problem, one can show that no constant factor approximation algorithm can be achieved unless p is equal to np. So these are negative results about the hardness of approximation. They show that even achieving a particular target, not for solving the problem exactly, but for maximizing the value of the solution, considered it as an optimization problem, you still get impossibility results unless p is equal to np. And the theorem that you use to get these results is something called the PC theorem, PCP theorem. Time will not permit me to go into that, but there's a whole theory of proving that that problems are not only fail to have polynomial time algorithms, but the solutions cannot even be approximated well in polynomial time. So now I want to turn away from complexity theory to talk about methods of solving some combinatorial problems, including NP-hard problems. And there's been a bit of a revolution in that area in which methods from continuous mathematics, calculus, linear algebra, and so on, can be used as well as the more familiar combinatorial arguments. So algorithmic methods from linear algebra have yielded improved methods for finding eigenvalues and eigenvectors, computing maximum flows and minimum cuts, solving systems of linear inequalities and equations, and convex optimization. In particular, the following question is the linear programming problem in this class. This is the problem of minimizing a linear function of n variables in n-dimensional real space, or rational space, doesn't matter, over a convex polyhedron described by linear inequalities. So if you wanted to picture what that problem is in geometric terms, the set of constraints of the set of linear inequalities comprising the input to the problem corresponds to a polyhedron in n-dimensional space. And we want to find the highest value possible at a point of that polyhedron for some linear function. And it can easily be shown that the maximum value occurs at a vertex of the polyhedron, a corner of the polyhedron. So that's the linear programming problem. Minimize a linear function of n variables over a convex polyhedron defined by linear inequalities. And back around 1950, just after the end of World War II, George Danzig gave a very good method for solving the linear programming problem. So this is the problem of finding, in a sense, the highest point on a given polyhedron. And Danzig's method is very simple. First, you get to a vertex of the polyhedron. How you do that, I won't describe. And starting at a vertex, you just look around the neighboring vertices, those that are joined to it by an edge, and see if any of them give a higher value of the objective function. And if so, you move to that neighbor, and you keep moving from point to point, vertex to vertex, as long as you can increase the objective function value, until you get stuck, and then you announce that you've reached the optimal solution. The simplex method is extremely useful, and in practice, it tends to solve linear programming problems, even in very high dimensions, very efficiently. But it's possible to give worst-case examples in which the simplex method runs for exponential time as a function of the dimension of the problem. So this is a case where you have a clash between complexity theory and practice. In practice, the simplex method is a good algorithm, but it doesn't satisfy the credential of complexity theory. It doesn't solve the problem in polynomial time, and in fact, the bad examples that have been constructed require exponential time. But since those bad examples are so special, the simplex method is regarded still as an extremely useful method. In 1984, Narendra Karmakar, a student of mine at one point, who also served later at the Tata Institute, gave a polynomial time algorithm for solving linear programming problems that is competitive with the simplex method but has a better standing in terms of worst case complexity. And briefly, this algorithm walks through a path in the interior of the polyhedron rather than along the edges and converges to an optimal solution. So Karmakar's method has the attribute of being polynomial time and is also quite competitive with the simplex algorithm in practice. And In recent years, Kamrakar's methods have been repeatedly improved, and the interior point methods are quite competitive with the simplex algorithm. So this underscores the conflict between complexity in practice and complexity in theory, because the simplex method is not good in theory, but good in practice. Another problem that is much harder than the linear programming problem is the so-called integer programming problem. This is the problem of minimizing a linear function of n variables subject to linear inequality constraints, and furthermore, the requirement that all the variables are integers. So if we think of the linear programming problem as the problem of finding, say, the highest point on a polyhedron, the integer programming problem is the problem of finding the highest point within a polyhedron among the points whose coordinates are all integers. And the integer programming problem is as hard as any optimization problem in NP. And yet, in practice, there are ways of attacking it, which use the idea of getting a linear programming relaxation. So what you do is the following. If you're given an integer programming problem, you temporarily drop the requirement that all the variables are integers. That converts it to a linear program. You solve the linear program. If the optimum point for the linear program happens to have integer coordinates, you're done. If it doesn't, you devise a new constraint, a new linear constraint that eliminates that solution from the problem and gives you a smaller problem, a smaller polyhedron, but without getting rid of the optimal integer solution. So repeatedly add further linear inequalities that exclude the current optimal solution, but preserve integer solutions. And there are very good software packages for solving integer programming problems, but these packages do not run in polynomial time. However, they work well enough in practice that one should follow the advice of my colleague Dan Gusfield. Always try integer programming. It may work. A much-studied combinatorial optimization problem is called the traveling salesman problem. This is the problem of a salesman who has to visit the N cities in his territory and wants to do so in at minimum travel cost. So the salesman is given the cost of traveling from city P to city Q. He's given the cost of doing that for any pair of cities. Furthermore, we'll assume that the cost function is symmetric. The time of cost for going from P to Q is the same as the cost for going from Q to P, and that the triangle inequality is satisfied. The cost of going from P to Q plus the cost of going from Q to R is greater than or equal to the cost of going from P to R. So these are reasonable constraints, especially if we're talking about problems where the cities are points in the plane. And this problem is to find a tour of minimum total distance or cost through the cities 1 through N, starting at some city and visiting all the cities and returning to the starting point. And it's an NP-hard problem. We shouldn't worry about that too much because, in fact, nowadays we don't have traveling salesmen at all. You just go to some online source and have it delivered you. Have things delivered to you by mail. So being a traveling salesman is no longer a very good choice of profession. But in any case, one can show that one can handle this problem very efficiently in practice, although not in theory, by formulating it as an integer programming problem, and then solving that integer programming problem by relaxing to an integer, to a linear program, inspecting the optimal solution, and then cutting off the optimal solution if it's not an integer solution. And in fact, huge instances of the traveling salesman problem can be solved by this method of using linear programming as a relaxation. And in practice, the traveling salesman problem is not considered such a hard problem. Let's see how we're doing on time. Okay, I can do a few more things. Here's a nice approximation algorithm for the traveling salesman problem. So in this problem, we're given a complete undirected graph with a vertex for each city and edges labeled with the cost associated with them, C of PQ, the cost of going from vertex P to vertex Q. And so let opt be an optimal tour. That's what we want to compute, but we don't know how to do it efficiently in the worst case. However, there are other problems related to it that we can do efficiently. One is called the minimum spanning tree problem. Here again, you have a graph with weights on the edges, and instead of requiring a tour through all of the vertices, as in the traveling salesman problem, you just have to pick a tree which spans all the vertices. In other words, a subgraph with a minimum number of edges which still allows you to move within that tree from any vertex to any other. So it's a tree is just a connected graph with no cycles. Another problem that you can solve efficiently is the matching problem. Suppose you're given an even number of vertices on a graph with weighted edges, and you want to pair them up in pairs such that the travel distances between the pairs add up to the smallest amount, the minimum cost matching of an even number of vertices. And that problem, it turns out, is also efficiently solvable. That problem is also in the class P. So here's a very cute algorithm for getting an approximation to the traveling salesman problem. You take a minimum spanning tree. That means that all of the vertices are connected in a single component. You then look at the odd degree vertices in that tree. There will be an even number of them by a basic fact of graph theory. And you match those odd degree vertices in pairs at minimum total cost. We know how to do that. And that gives us the tree plus the match. And that is a connected graph that contains all the vertices and has all of its degrees even, which by a basic fact of graph theory means that there's a closed walk that covers all of the edges in tree plus match. The cost of the tree is less than or equal to the cost of the optimal solution, and one can show that the cost of the match is at most half the cost of the optimal solution. So the cost of this closed walk is at most 3/2 the cost of the optimal solution. And we can convert the closed walk to a tour by bypassing repeated vertices, which does not increase the length because of the triangle inequality. And the results then a tour whose cost is easily computed and is at most 3/2 times the cost of the optimal solution. Well, I'm getting behind time a little bit, so I'm going to just mention one more problem, and then I'll conclude with a few general remarks. The one-dimensional bin packing is the following. You have items to be packed into bins where the capacity of an item is some number between 0 and 1, and the cost of the bin is 1, the size of the bin is 1. And in this very simple bin packing problem, the problem is to pack all of the given items, which have fractional sizes, into a minimum number of unit size bins where the sum of the sizes of the numbers packed into any bin is less than or equal to the size of the bin. It's a simple heuristic which achieves a cost at most 11/9 times the cost of an optimal solution, plus 4. The heuristic is very simple. You just arrange the bins in some order, and then you go through all of the items, and starting with the largest and moving down to the smallest in decreasing order of size. And as each item is encountered, you put it in the earliest bin in the ordering that can accept it, given what's already been placed in that bin. And this heuristic achieves 11/9 times the opt plus 4, so it's a pretty good and easily performed approximation algorithm. Time will not permit me to talk about a more sophisticated algorithm, except to say that, that this more sophisticated algorithm finds a solution within an additive factor of order log n. So that's incredibly close to a really optimal solution. The problem is as hard as NP, so you don't expect optimal solutions. And here you get very close with just an additive error term of log n. And this is a recent theoretical result by Rothfuss and Hoberg. So there's a little summary of various combinatorial optimization problems. And one of the themes I tried to stress is the occasional discrepancy between worst-case complexity and complexity in practice. For example, the bin packing problem is NP-complete, but getting an extremely good approximate solution is relatively easy. So the problem is tractable in practice, but not in theory. Similarly, for the linear programming problem, using the simplex method, solvable efficiently in practice, but not in theory. So again, what this means is that if you encounter a problem and prove that it's NP-complete, don't give up. You can still find an approximation algorithm or just a practical algorithm that will meet your needs. So I'd like to close with a few open problems. The biggest one is the one we started with in the first half of the talk. Is P equal to NP? Is the set of decision problems solvable in polynomial time the same as the set of problems solvable in polynomial time with the help of polynomial size hints? In general, a theme to be studied is to characterize the performance of exact and approximate algorithms for NP-hard problems on typical instances or instances with special structure. So we see that even though the satisfiability problem is NP-hard, NP-complete, it turns out that on the instances that typically arise in practice, experience shows that they can be solved very efficiently. There are new classes of algorithms coming along that we really don't understand, whose performance in practice we don't understand. We don't understand why satisfiability is so easy in practice, or why integer programming works fairly well in practice. And then in the recent area of machine learning and, I hate to use the term, but I'll say artificial intelligence. I don't like to use that term because I reserve that for a kind of intelligence that people have, a universal intelligence about the world, whereas what people currently call AI deals with the ability to solve narrowly defined problems in practice. Anyway, we have algorithms for deep learning and for playing games like chess or shogi or Go, which perform incredibly well. This, I refer, for example, to the game-playing program AlphaZero that some of you have seen. And we have no means of explaining, at least as far as I can see, why those algorithms perform as well as they do. So I encourage those of you who are bold and brave enough to spend some of your time thinking about why these algorithms work as well as they do. And for that, at that point, I think I'll stop. So thank you. Okay, time for some questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Karp, for a very grand tour of the challenging problems in complexity theory. Questions, yeah. Wait till the mic comes to you.
Hello, sir. With recent advancements in quantum computing, does it really give us another perspective on the P versus NP problem?
Doesn't change the problem. The question is, will quantum computing help us crack the P versus NP problem? Okay. And I don't think the answer is, I think the answer is no.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I wanted to ask a question about, you mentioned about how in the simplex method and so on, when things, while it's in theory non-polynomial, but in practice you never really encounter. So is there a way to refine these classes where you say that it's polynomial except for cases which are exponentially small, like e to the minus n, or that it's polynomial for the quantifying the majority of cases for which it is this thing, and that it fails in exponentially small cases or in polynomially small cases?
Yes, there is a way to do this. For example, if we take the linear programming problem, the input is a point in a matrix, actually, in n-dimensional space, so a point in a higher dimensional space. And you can show that if you draw a little ball around any point, then with probability one within that ball, the simplex method will work fine. Mm-hmm. So that's there are results of that kind. And then there are many results which show that if a problem has a certain structural property, then it'll be easily solved. For example, if a clustering problem has the property that all of the nearly optimal solutions resemble each other very much, then one can show that it's easy to find an optimal solution. And there's a series of examples of that kind.
So classically, in computability theory, we know from Rice's theorem that understanding Turing machines is essentially undecidable in most cases. So do you think similar barriers might underlie the question of understanding deep networks?
You know, I haven't studied, I've forgotten what Rice's theorem says. Can you remind me?
Yeah, so what Rice's theorem says is that if you partition the set of languages into two, and given the description of a Turing machine, you would like to construct a Turing machine that tells you which side of the partition the language corresponding to the Turing machine lies in. Then the question of solving that problem is undecidable for a large class of such partitions.
Yes, I don't know the answer to your question for polynomial time computing. Sorry. I've got to brush up on my computability theory. I haven't taught that course for a long time.
How about expected complexity?
Pardon?
Expected complexity. The randomized kind of complexity.
What is the term?
Instead of worst case complexity.
Yes.
How about on the instances are random?
Oh, I see. Yes. The question is, what can you show about the complexity of some of these algorithms when the input string is drawn from some probability space? So that's what you were asking. So I worked on that quite a bit. I enjoyed working on that and got some very nice results in the 1970s. But I couldn't get the complexity theory community to get interested in those results, because they rejected my hypothesis that a simple probability distribution described the set of typical instances. I used the Eritish-Reni random graphs, the simplest possible model for random graphs. I could prove that in that model, many problems are easily solvable in polynomial time with high probability. But the results were not found to be interesting enough to enable me to continue on that, even though I regretted leaving it because I was having a lot of fun. So just they wouldn't accept that notion of that description of the typical problems.
So we'll take one question from the live streaming. There are people joining in. And there's a question from Sharmila at the IIIT in Bangalore, and also works at Samsung. She asks, machine learning problems fall under which category? And what kind of research is there on it?
Well, they vary. I mean, there's simple statistical methods to draw a line through a set of points to minimize mean squared distance and so on. So there are simple problems there, but the big ones, the pattern recognition problems, the speech analysis, the machine translation, those problems have fairly complicated descriptions.
So do they, I think her question was whether they fall into these kind of categories.
Oh, I see. No, I don't think so. I think they're outside P.
The outside P, yeah.
Yeah.
So any further questions?
Given that we have not succeeded for so many years in finding a solution to this question, is it possible that we need to go beyond existing mathematics and computer science? For example, we might need to add some axioms or something. In mathematics, for example, we found that in set theory, certain problems like the continuum hypothesis are independent of set theory.
Yeah.
Is it possible that something like this could be happening out here in computer science also?
There have been a few conjectures that some people have conjectured that that the P versus NP problem could be independent of, I don't know if it's set theory or but some respectable theory. There are conjectures along these lines, but no results that I know of. Yeah. Well, thank you again.
Thank you very much. Let's thank Professor Karp for a very insightful talk. And I invite you to come for refreshments outside. It's high tea. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Let's see.